All right, and take two, and three, and a two, and a one. It's Sunday, August 25th, 4 days before my birthday, 2019. I'm Jeff.
Who's your bear? That's right. I am your bear.
I'm Damon.
I don't brew the tea. I just serve it.
And that makes me Gary.
Don't hurt nobody with your bad self.
Welcome to Comes Out Loud, the Bear Podcast with a Turn Length, episode number 522. And we have TB, our trans bear, with us. Yay! I put it in the top right. I don't know what that means. Anyways.
Well, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
I don't know if there's any significance for top right, or if tops are supposed to be in the right, or flagging is so weird to me. I don't get it.
Well, actually, Jeff, if we want to get real technical about it, you should always be in the top right.
Hold on a second.
Because that means you top from the bottom. Did you get it, David?
I got it.
That just kind of broke.
Stop breaking me, Gary. God damn it.
There we go. I'm in the top right.
What are you doing, Jeff?
I'm now in the top right. So now...
Oh, good Lord.
There we go. Sorry.
It's okay.
Everybody got to watch that live for whoever's watching the video. The whole
visual for everybody. Those of you watching us live on YouTube, enjoy the psychedelic show that's happening.
It's not a psychedelic show. It's just images moving around on the screen. That's all. Mm. Anyways, moving on. Gary.
Yes, Jeff? All right, so for those of you that have been listening to some of the more recent episodes of Comes Out Loud, we did an entire show as feedback to a letter that we received, and then we also got some further clarification and feedback, which I think we did at our feedback show last month. So basically, we've had these communications going on, and TB is the individual who was reaching out and chatting with us and stuff. So we, in all transparency, I want everyone kind of to know in the audience that we have been wanting to do this topic for probably a year and a half or longer. We have a topic list of different things that we want to get to. But the honesty was that we didn't quite feel that we knew anybody that we, you know, connected with and we wanted to have on the show. And so we made the offer to TP, like, hey, it's been great, you know, doing this email back and forth kind of communication thing. And we were like, you know, you're welcome to come on and stuff. So here we are.
Yay!
So there was a couple of things we wanted to go over. I thought we might not go over certain things that I think a lot of people are already aware of in terms of, you know, what certain things are for, like, trans in terms of, like, the broader sense of it. And I more I thought about it, I wanted to talk more, TB, with you about, like, your experiences specifically, because I think what some people sometimes confuse but can understand is, like, the coming out process, like finding your identity and being an authentic individual, like even when you want to be, you know, come out as a gay person, as a lesbian person, all of that is specific. So while we can talk in generalities, what happens for one person is not necessarily the case for everybody.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
So, so kind of one of the things we talked about before to start off with was, what was it like discovering that you're a trans individual, you know? Was that
so sorry if you hear my dogs outside. I'm hoping someone
That's
else
okay.
in the house.
Puppies!
But anyway, for me personally, it was confusing. I have a really long discovering I was trans story, because actually, like, one of my very, very first memories is, like, my parents being, like, out on a date and my brother babysitting me, and I'm, like, 2 or 3 at this point, and, like, we were, like, watching a movie, and me being like, I wish I was a boy, and my brother being like, well, that's not a thing that children say. And,
wow. Okay.
And, like, you know, like, even, like, at 2 or 3 having, like, this internalized thought of, like, oh, I guess that's, like, not an okay thing to tell people. So, you know, like, I didn't for a long time, because, and, you know, like, at 2 or 3 you usually don't have any, like, concept of, like, other people being like that. And then when I was, like, I want to say 11 or 12, I was watching Oprah with my mom after school one day, and like, there were, like, she was interviewing, like, various trans people, and I was like, wow, like, I think, I feel like that. And, you know, also being, like, 11 or 12 or whatever, not, and, like, having this memory of, like, telling my brother this, I was like, okay, I know what I'll do. Because I also had the thought of, like, well, I feel like I'm a man, but I also know that I'm attracted to men, and, like, none of the trans people that Oprah had on, like, they were all, like, straight trans people, so I was like, well, maybe, like, maybe that's not, like, a thing. And, you know, so the obvious thought to my, like, 12-year-old brain was like, I'll send Oprah an email. And, like,
yes!
I sadly did not get a response.
boo! Shame on the Black Talk Show goddess for not replying to you specifically. I mean, come on.
I was so sad, but I like, I had that thought. I was like, hey, I just watched, you know, your episode with trans people, and I think I might be trans, but, you know, not exactly like that. And, you know, Oprah never responded, so hey, I let it be. And then when I was, like, 16, I was at a church camp with my family, and not to go over, like, all of our religious things, but it was, like, a specifically LGBT church camp.
Oh.
Yeah. And, like, my uncle's gay and participates in the church a lot. But anyway, like, I was rooming with him, and he was telling me about a trans woman at his congregation that was a lesbian. And I was, it was like this big, like, revelation moment for me that I was like, oh, like, there are trans people who are also, like, you know, LGBT in other ways as well. And I remember being, like, super excited and, like, walking down the hall to, like, the room in this lodge that my mom and dad had, and, like, being like, I'm gonna come out to my mom right now that I have, like, an in. And I started by telling her about this person at my uncle's congregation. She went, oh, that's weird. And I was like, yep, that's weird. And then did not come out to her.
It's like,
you were like,
red flag, not the time.
Yeah.
Not yet.
Yep. I was just like, oh, yep, that's weird, and just, like, flipped around and walked away.
Let me just put a pin in that one for me.
Yeah. But I did end up coming out later that same year, because it was, like, Thanksgiving Day, and I don't know, I still to this day don't know who my mom was on the phone with, but she was on the phone with someone and, like, looked over at me and said something like, you know, I've asked her if she wants to be a man, and she said no. And I was like, you have not asked me that. You've certainly asked me if I was a lesbian, which is not true.
Wow. You're like, let me get my fans so I can call you out on that shit. Like,
yeah, so I, like, after hearing, like, her half of that phone call, I, like, set up a thing, and I was like, okay, I'll tell her on Monday. So that Monday, I did. But, but, like, referencing back to something that Gary said in one of the other episodes, where you were referencing, like, your coming out and talking about, like, discovering who you were, And like considering if you were trans for a bit and being like, well, no, I don't, I think I'm just attracted to men. Mm-hmm. So that's like a relatively common misconception I've heard about trans people is like that it's just kind of like being gay, but like a step farther. And, you know, it's not like they're not like, I like who you're attracted to and who you identify as like aren't connected. And I'm not like calling you out. I'm just saying that's like mm-hmm. a common thing that I've heard. And it's, you know,
I think it's a part of the self-discovery process because mm-hmm. I was struggling with my identity. And for a time, like my father actually asked me at one point, like if once I came out as gay, he wanted to know if I wanted to be a woman. And I think that was his way of trying to understand like yeah. where I really was like, and that was something that you were just talking about, TB, that I wanted to say, which is, you know, that trans identity, like, you know, this understanding of yourself is not about orientation in terms of like sexuality. It's about like your who you are and your own identity. You know, this is how I feel that I am. This is what, you know, it makes me, you know, live my most fullest life. And so I've met individuals that are trans that are both gay and lesbian and straight. Like it's, you know.
Yeah.
I just realized, not that this is a bingo game, I haven't met a trans individual that's bisexual, but I imagine that's
completely possible. Well, yeah. I know quite a few, but.
Okay.
And so I don't identify as bi, but there was a you know, a good period of time between emailing Oprah and when I came out that I was like, well, maybe I'm bi, since I still hadn't ever heard of a gay trans person. I was like, maybe that's what these feelings are. I was like, I know I'm attracted to men and kind of want to be a man, so maybe this is just what being bi feels like, and I don't know that.
Wow. Well, I think you're describing what's a natural, what most of us kind of refer to as experimentation, and sometimes it's jokingly about like experimenting. But I know for me, I had three girlfriends in high school, and I determined through, you know, dating these three individuals who I'm connected with all of them on Facebook, they're great, beautiful women. I don't have interest in them. You know, I they're great people, physically. But I don't want to, you know, get down and dirty with them. So,
yeah.
And I think that that's what everybody goes through. I think the majority of individuals have far less of a path in terms of like, you know, branching and determining for themselves. If you are born in the binary concept of a man or a woman, and you like the opposite gender, you may not necessarily really experiment, quote unquote, with same gender. You just may like naturally, you know, be with someone of the opposite gender and, you know, all the fireworks go off, everything works and you're perfectly content. Good for you. But that's not necessarily, you know, the case for other individuals, you know. So I'm very intrigued by the course of your life, especially with the church aspect that it appears you were brought into a more open environment, you know, in terms of that, like, you know, with your gay uncle who's active in spirituality. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah. And like my parents actually are too. So that was like one of the weird things about like coming out to them, because they're like my mom is a pastor currently, and my dad has previously been a pastor, but they've also like always been pro-LGBT. And in fact, like, not to talk about like my early memories too much, but you know, I have the story with my brother, and then another very early memory is going to gay pride because my parents had volunteered to drive one of the floats. I don't actually remember anything about pride other than me having to sit in the truck and being like, this is such a hot day. Why are we outside? I hate it.
Same. So much the same.
But yeah, I not a, not a whole lot has changed on that front. I regret to say. I mean, in some cities, they do leave the pride out of the hot summer season slightly. Yeah, but
like it was so very warm. Although apparently, I've heard a story that even though I was quite young and didn't exactly have a concept of gay people, I certainly could distinguish them because we were at Pride, and you know, my uncle lives like in California and not in our state, and like being at Pride at like 3 years old and being like, where's Uncle Keith? Like, he should be here with all these people. So
you had some concept of gaydar, like even at a young age, like you were able to kind of
like
see
even
the,
if you
the
didn't really know what made these people different, like it was still like I could tell him like, well, he should be here with these people, like this is where Uncle Keith goes.
This is where the party is, and
but either way, my family has always been like, you know, strong in religion but also like heavily into LGBT stuff, and like my parents have like bookshelves in every room of their house, and it's really funny because you can go there and it'll like be like the teachings of Matthew, and then directly next to it will be like human sexuality. like they have a bunch of stuff, and like you know, like I know I could go like over right above their fireplace and grab like multiple things of like queering religion and homosexual saints and wow. Like a bunch of so I knew they would be accepting, but it was also weird coming out to them because, you know, most people had never heard of a gay trans person. Like, had I been coming out as like a straight trans man or like a lesbian, they would have been like totally fine and understanding. Mm-hmm. But coming out as that, like, it was
getting the combo in there.
Yeah, it was really confusing them. And then I also know it was like, it hurt me a lot to hear my mom say this, and she's grown so much since this. It was just, you know, this was her first reaction is like her saying like, oh, me and your dad have always been so liberal. I think you're not actually trans. You're just like wanting an identity, so you're saying this.
Wow.
Maybe it's like the worry that the fact that they're so nurturing and the acceptance of trans and LGBT that they never thought of, or trans and gay, that the combination just kind of like, wait a minute, those wait, go what? Together? They're hard to compute? And it's just kind of an inability to understand that both of those could happen at the same time.
Yeah, which...
I mean, I think people, we get really stuck into, like, patterns of structure. And so, like, even within the gay community, we've talked in previous episodes, I think, about the fact that, you know, individuals who identify themselves as bisexual find it very challenging because even within the gay community, there are, I can't speak for lesbians per se, but I've seen many a gay man be like, you know, well, you just, you know, you're just gay, like you just are choosing that label, you know, whatever, to be different or something. And I'm kind of like, it's not that simple. It's not that, you know, to keep using this word over and over again, but it's not that binary. It's not black and white. There's lots of like in between areas. And so while I hear what you're saying, TB, that it was harsh, I think especially parents find themselves in really challenging moments when their child is telling them things that they don't know and or understand. I mean, my own mother struggled at first when I first came out to her. And it wasn't, you know, an awful experience, but it was difficult when they don't believe you. You're just kind of like, okay, well, yeah, okay. That's just, I think it's kind of mind-boggling. And so we also as humans have a really weird capacity to do like unbelievable things when we're stressed. And so I think when we feel overwhelmed, we say and do things that are not necessarily the best in the moment. I mean, it's good to hear that your mom's, you know.
Yeah, and, like, it would hurt so much more if, like, that had been, like, a foundational, like, breaking moment, and she hadn't grown beyond that. It just, it hurt quite a bit when it happened, but, you know.
Things have changed.
Yes, right. She has certainly grown and learned things, and so relating back to religion, just because this is interesting. So, like, a few months after, like, the initial coming out, which I also came out at a point that was a relatively easy point to transition, because I came out, like, partway through, like, my senior year of high school. So I just lived out the rest of my senior year kind of, like, frustratingly. And then over the summer, just, like, you know, picked a new name and, like, was going to start introducing myself that way at college, where I was going to get, like, an all new social circle.
Fresh start.
Yeah. But, you know, my parents have always been really, like, active in the church, obviously. So when, like, over that summer while I was moved off to college, like, pretty quick after I moved off to college, like, they didn't want me coming home for Christmas and feeling really uncomfortable. So they, like, threw a dinner party at the church converse, like, at the church to, like, be like, hey, you know, we don't have a daughter, we have a son, and we're gonna have like a big Q&A with, like, people at the church that where they answered questions to, like, try and make it, like, more comfortable if I, like, came back and, like, they wanted to do, like, something church related for Christmas. So so
interesting.
Yeah, it certainly was.
So in your experience of coming out to your family, at least your immediate family, it seems that things were pretty good in terms of, you know, what people would expect as an experience. They were already in a more open mindset in terms of,
yeah,
you know.
Like, and I'm very lucky for that, I know, because a lot of people certainly aren't.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What about friends? Did you, you know, did you kind of close one chapter and then start a whole new one, you know, in the changing of your identity and who you are, you know, or was that, you know, kind of also a little bit, you know, where some people were receptive?
So, I, like, I just turned 27 this week, so I'm still, like, relatively on the younger side for a bear. So, like, most of my friends are totally receptive to that. And, I'm still in contact with quite a few people from high school. There's, I'm sure, quite a few that I, like, have written off and don't talk to anymore, but most of the people that I was, like, close with in high school totally got it, understood, liked it, were happy, and, you know. So my friends have mostly been good, but I think that's a big part of, like, the communities I was already in, because I, like, was already in a lot of, like, queer spaces and art spaces where it's just, like, this is, you know, something that's, like, already accepted from the get-go type of thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then, like, in college, I went to an art college. So, again, it's a very queer space to begin with.
Oh, those art kids. So, so different.
Yeah.
The unique. Theaters,
unique.
Arts.
Unique.
No, they're not unique. It's just a different group. It's mm-hmm. There's so many of us.
Now, with your experience in being authentically who you are, did you have an experience in terms, or have had any experiences in terms of coming out to coworkers, or have you not really had, like, a job when that was happening in which you just...
I haven't really come out to any of my coworkers because at, like, most of my previous jobs, I haven't really, like, known or gotten close to anyone because they were really terrible jobs where I did not enjoy my coworkers. And then at my current job, like, it hasn't been necessary. And I'm, like, friends with quite a few people, but also the couple people that I'm friends with, I'm like, oh, you don't have fully formed opinions yet, because my office skews pretty young, where, like, a lot of the people are in their very early 20s and, like, are straight. Like, one guy, like, I know he's, like, pro-gay rights, but then he also talked about, like, being nervous going to a gay bar. And I'm like, ah, shut up.
Just as a complete sidebar, I don't know why straight men feel so threatened by gay men that, like, you know, we're going to prey upon them, you know, and I guess, like, fantasy rape them or something. Like a weird homophobia kind of thing. I'm like, really? Really? You think that your ass is that sweet? I don't think so. Like, you need to, like, check yourself.
But you're not. Like, half the time. No.
So back
if you're watching the world's strongest men for your job and you're drooling, it's kind of hard to do, but we'll get in there.
In the chat, someone just asked what line of work I'm in. I'm in a tech office, and I'm 27, and most of the people on my team are, like, in their mid to early 20s. And I guess technically there's one person at the office that I'm out to, but it's my boyfriend, so I don't think that counts.
Well, I sure hope you're out to your boyfriend, just to say.
Right, I was just going to say, I'm kind of thinking that's something you would talk about.
Yeah.
That would be very important.
And we weren't dating when he got me the job, but, like, we had been friends for years, and he knew how much I hated my previous job, and he said, well, there's a open position at my office, do you want me to turn in your resume? And then we started dating since then, and, you know, since we've started dating since then, none of our coworkers know, because we felt like it'd be interesting to tell them, especially because it's a contract position that is unfortunately ending soon. So it hasn't really seemed like, let's tell. Yeah, us too. We're hoping to find something that's not contract. But either way, I guess technically one person at the office knows, but not really in a coworker way.
Nice. They know from a different angle.
Yes.
Perspective. Yes.
Or multiple Philip
was
angles.
Asking a follow-up question about, like, does your relationship play a role at work at all? Or, like, are you both on the same team? Or are you, you know?
We are. And, like, you know, before we started dating, we were really good friends. And everyone at the office knew that. So since we haven't told anyone, I don't think it's really, like, come across any more than the fact that, like, everyone knew when I got hired that I was a very good friend of his because, you know, we were established friends from before that.
Right. What was your experience, like, TB, in terms of, like, your self-image? By that I mean, like, did you find yourself, like, trying to determine better who you are, or did you kind of feel pretty certain or maybe cemented, like, you know, like, I understand who I am and, like, I'm completely satisfied and comfortable with this?
So that's a interesting one because like, right up until like, it's silly. I don't think that this person, I've talked to her, but I don't think that she knows how much of, like, a strong impact she's had on my life of, like, the lesbian trans woman from my uncle's congregation. Like right up until he was telling me about her, like, that was, like, literally a very transformational moment in my life. And, like, before that, I had a lot of self-image issues and like, internal and external, and, you know, hated myself quite a bit, and not that those are entirely gone since then, but, like, that moment changed a lot of things, and then, like, for a lot of, like, the external self-image, like, starting testosterone and stuff helped with that, since I can do things like, you know, grow a beard now, and things like that.
And a gorgeous beard it is, by the way.
Thank you. But I certainly still experience a lot of that, but it's, like, you know, the idea of, like, coming out to myself really helped that, because, like, before that, I struggled with a lot of things like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, now more than ever, I think individuals, younger individuals, I should say, that are identifying themselves and determining things, I think they don't have as much perhaps like resistance in terms of their self-image, like what they see and what they want. I know for me coming out, I kind of wandered around mentally and like understanding who I am and how I wanted to see myself, and, you know, easily co-opted imagery and other things, like, because, you know, I wanted to feel included, so I would do XYZ, and then found into my 30s and then coming to like my 40s, like, which is, I think, common. You just kind of don't give a shit as much. So you just say, well, you know, this is the way I am. This is the way things are, you know, yeah. and be more comfortable with that. Mm. For the with the LGBTQ community, given what your family has been like, did you find that, you know, it was an easy integration? Like, once you determined for yourself, oh, I can be trans individual and be gay, as opposed to being heterosexual, I guess is the way to phrase that. You know, did you find that was, you know, I don't want to say easy, but, you know, yeah, not very challenging.
So it depends on like where you are in like an LGBT space. Cause like, I think it's really easy to like integrate when you're like in a space that's like entirely LGBT and not like a gay space. Mm-hmm. Like integrating to like my college's like gay straight alliance type thing, which it was relatively easy to integrate into, although I will say I made everyone hate me in the first 30 seconds. and then I changed all of their opinions, but it was, they were doing a thing where like every week for the first however long the club existed, talking about like all of the different alphabet soup letters that people might not be as familiar with. So like, right, gay and lesbian and bi, I think we're all like clumped onto one day because most people are like, I get this, I understand. But when you start getting to like the A's and the I's and the U's and whatnot, and I hadn't been to a couple of the first meetings, and then the first one that I showed up to was like the day they were going over you, and they were calling it undecided, and you know, no one in that room knew me, and I went, I hate undecided, and a lot of people like looked at me like, what the fuck is this guy talking about? He's being a huge asshole. And then I went on to explain that I just wish the club was calling it undeclared, because decided makes it sound like you're making a decision to be gay or a decision like, and I was just like, it's fine if you don't know your identity, but you're not deciding it, you're figuring it out, like,
or unclear.
Yeah, so after like for the first 30 seconds everyone was like, who the fuck is this asshole? And then I explained my position and they were like, actually, you know what, we will change it from undecided.
But that, I mean, you bring up a really important distinction though, TB. I think that people don't understand, because it's been going on for so long, there's always been jokes about it, there's been, you know, kind of, and sometimes people have actually said, because maybe they didn't have a different way to refer to it, that they decided, you know, fill in the blank. I think I may have kind of made reference to that. But yeah, to be fair, when I came out in my freshman year of college, I didn't decide that I was gay. I basically had like the honest talk within myself of exactly, of the declaration to say, yep, it's men. That's where it lies, you know.
And I just think it's just because like that decide is such like loaded language when you think about like the like pray away the gay type of thing where it's like, well, you decided to be this way, that I was just like, you know, hey, maybe we should not use this word, because there's plenty of other words that you can say that will get across the same idea of like, you haven't discovered what about yourself is true, but you're not making a decision. You're just like on a journey.
Right. And I think people forget that that's what happens for technically most individuals, like I even believe that those that identify as heterosexual go through a journey. They just maybe don't recognize it.
Yeah, because a lot of times it's a relatively short journey because you can see yourself depicted in media and be like, yep, that's how I feel. I think you're muted, Damon.
Fuck.
This is just the normal show.
Hi.
That's all right.
With the spaces, you made reference, though, about how there's a difference between them and that, like, a gay space is not the same as, like, a general encompassing, you know, all the alphabet kind of space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I have a few different stories ranging from, like, neutral to, like, bad. So I'll start with the bad one. I was at a gay bar with a different trans... Well, I wasn't at it. I was meeting him afterwards, but he was at a gay bar, and a very drunk man came up and, like, groped him and did not quite find, you know, what he was expecting, since this person has not had bottom surgery, and then got very aggressive, which I feel like is also pretty douchey, considering he just, like, groped someone without consent and then was upset that. when he didn't find, like, you know, the that. More traditional penis that he was looking for.
Yeah. Well, right. I mean, I think the three of us automatically were all like, hello, like, where's the consent in this moment? Like, you know, there's fun sexiness, but, like, to just walk up to a complete stranger that is uncalled for. You
know? Yeah. I'll go into, like, different stories, but just to expound more on this, trans women definitely experience more of, like, trap culture, where, like, men will, and if you don't know that term, that's, like, something straight men will say, that like, a trans woman will, like, trap them, because, and that's really just, like, you were attracted to this woman, and then you got very angry when you found out that, you know, she wasn't quite the woman that you thought she was, but that's not really her fault that you thought she was hot.
Yeah.
And like, trans men certainly experience that less than trans women, but it doesn't not happen.
Yeah.
And like that experience for my friend at that bar is similar to that. If that guy was, you know, he obviously came up to my friend and groped him because he thought he was hot. Like, you know, mm-hmm. like, it was a, like, you know, I think that you are an attractive person kind of way. The consent thing is definitely bad, but, like, ignoring that for a small moment, the after effect is he was so angry because he felt like my friend had, like, trapped and lied to him. And I'm like, this is a stranger. Like, he has not lied to you by existing in a gay bar at the same space as you.
Right. Yeah, there's a huge dynamic difference in being, like, in a public realm and making some presumptions versus being, like, in an intimate location, perhaps like someone's home, in which, you know, it may evolve into, you know, sexual relations, like, where I would hope there would be conversation, you know, some communication before, you know, such things. I mean, I just made this reference online recently. Someone was making a reference to senior citizens having sex, and someone kind of made a crack about, you know, well, I hope that they used protection because they couldn't imagine someone being a senior citizen being pregnant. And I was kind of like, well, not only that, but, you know, like,
senior citizens have, like, the most rampant STD growth currently because they're having so much sex. Like,
so as someone who has a parent who is a part of that demographic, you know, I'm kind of like, okay, like, you know, make sure that you're educated and you're well informed. And
yeah,
so to me, I think, you know, there always should be some type of communication of things, but I get it. Like, I am by no means a saint about this. There has been times in my past in which it gets I don't want to say logic, but a lot of things just kind of get pushed to the side because hormones take over and things get, you know.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then, so that's, like, one of the really bad experiences, but, like, jumping back to, like, more neutral ones, there have been times where I've been, like, a gay space and someone's flirting with me and, like, I don't want to be like, you know, hold on, stop your flirting. There's something you need to know first. Because
I have some news.
That transition gets a little awkward.
Yeah, because, like, A, it can totally, like, ruin the mood of flirting, even if the person would be totally okay with it. And B, as already mentioned, sometimes people will get, like, violent. So I've found, like, struggles in, like, flirting with people. So I've gone to a few bear events, but normally when I go, I only play with people that I've, like, talked to online previously, because I just don't know how to navigate, like, hey, this hot guy at the pool is flirting with me. How do I, like, even if he'd be totally fine with me being trans, how do I talk to him about that at the pool and then go up to my room? I'm like, I'll just, you know, look at the guys that are at this event on Growler, flirt with them on Growler, and then if I see them at the pool,
maybe talk to them.
Have the conversation, not face-to-face.
Well, and that's because, like, it's in my Growler stats. Like, if you see my profile, it's like, you know, this is a trans man. And then, like, in my, I also make it, like, the first word of my bio is, like, hey, I'm transgender. I have, like, such,
of course, right. And then you need to make sure they're reading the profile or the name is kind of representing it clear and straightforward. Yeah. And it's such a hassle.
Well, I mean, I think
but a hassle.
The challenge in this case, TB, what you're describing is, you know, the presumptiveness that people have about, you know, other individuals.
Especially in, like, Evron's and events and bear spaces and gay male spaces.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, that's kind of, I think, parallel to, like, thinking that all really tall men over 6 feet are tops and then all really short guys around 5 feet are all bottoms. Like, that's, you know, a thing that that we've not discussed yet, I don't think, ever on this podcast.
No. But it's quite
the presumption. And I'm like, oh, trust me, there are lots of little guys at the top that would love to climb a mountain of a man. So, you know, that's so
true.
That's, you know, not a fair presumption that people make. And I think, you know, the more familiarity individuals have, I think the more comfortable spaces will be for individuals that we don't make those presumptions right off the bat. I mean, I remember many years ago, there was a presumption that all drag queens were bottoms. And then having known quite a few drag queens, actually, I was like, that is not always the case.
No.
Just for the record.
Yeah, well, and it's like a ridiculous thing to think because, I can...
Statistically speaking.
Well, I think there's a thing where they make a presumption because they take on a feminine identity, even if it is hyperly dramatic, they automatically presume that therefore they're passive and that they receive.
Yeah. And I understand why people go down that thought process, but I'm also think it's, you know, silly just because what you do in one space does not dictate what you do in another.
That's so true.
It's like, you know, even if it's more feminine or whatnot, it's not like you're, generally speaking, I'm sure there are some drag queens that do have sex and drag, but
there's some kinky and drag queens out there, I'm sure.
But, like, even then, that, like, just because you're doing drag doesn't mean, like, that's where you're taking
your entire life.
Yeah.
Your entire life is not just your drag. That's a persona.
Yeah.
And sometimes for many people, it goes back in the closet once everything's gone. The show is over.
Yeah.
But anyway, you know, it's... That's the one thing I will say is the worst part is, like, the assumptions that people sometimes make in general about things, especially in, like, gay male spaces, is the whole, like, you know, every person there is apparently going to have a penis and every person there is going to be wanting to do things that involve penises.
Yeah. I'll admit that even with if we deal with consent part, if I end up reaching down, if we've already dealt with the consent part, I should say, and I reach down into the area and I'm not getting what I'm expecting, I would at least be like surprised.
Yeah.
But the whole aggressive thing, and it's probably just me and my it, being the Minnesota nice guy, it's I'm having a hard time understanding people getting super angry about it. I would just be like surprised and maybe have a moment where I back away. Or if I'm not in the mood for that, be like, oh, I'm sorry, and move on. But it's hard for me to cut. There's a lot of things within the past 10 years or less that because of everything that's been ingrained in my mind about everything, especially with the more visibility of trans people, that it's sometimes hard to make that transition and make that get that respect because it's not something you're used to, and it's very difficult sometimes. I'm happy to say that I've grown a lot, especially within the past few years, on it. And I just hope that more people are, just because you didn't get what you were exactly expecting, it doesn't mean you have to be rude or mean about it. But
yeah, for my friend in particular, I actually feel relatively thankful that this person seemed to be quite drunk, because in their at least in the retelling I heard, the person like went to throw a punch, but it was a little bit too loose because they weren't very stable. After that, my friend was like, okay, well, I'm gonna leave this bar now. And like, even if the vast majority of guys wouldn't do that, it's really difficult to know who would.
Mm-hmm.
So it's hard to like
be in
that situation, which, you know, is again why like anytime I've hooked up with somebody, it's basically been like, hey, this is someone I was messaging online first, because I already know that this person is like okay with stuff, instead of trying to like come out
to them in a moment.
Because, you know, if I'm flirting with a guy at a pool and I'm like, and tell him I'm trans, he's like, oh, you know what? Never mind. That would be okay. I mean, it would hurt, but whatever. Hmm. But I don't want it to be like, tell a guy I'm trans and him be like, oh, and either like be aggressive or, you know, just in general be like, well, that's fucking gross. Like, I also, like, even if it's not a, like, actively physically body threatening and aggressive, it's also just unpleasant to be around people that, because, you know, if somebody has the opinion of like, you know what, no thanks, that's okay. But if they go into the territory of like, oh, that's gross and you shouldn't be here, even if they aren't like physically threatening me, it's still
kind of still
not enjoyable.
Mm-hmm.
And that can sometimes be worse than just them actually being aggressive, physical, and
honestly, it very well could be, because if you were to run and somebody got like physically aggressive, most likely they would get thrown out. Versus if somebody's just like, well, you're fucking gross, unfortunately, they'd probably still be allowed to stay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's about circumstance and what would happen in that moment. Like, you know, making a negative, like, verbal like comment is one thing, but, you know, to be physically aggressive, you know, or to escalate, yeah, you know, in a situation, I agree, is something else. And yeah, I mean, it I think what you're really revealing, TV, is like that there's a significant amount of caution in like explaining and understanding and you know, being aware of what the circumstances are. But I think, I mean, I recall that I felt that way in coming out myself, like, many times, because I didn't know how individuals were going to feel. And I think as more and more experiences came along, I less and less like was cautious and cared, you know, in that case. And maybe it's just, you know, the age, maturity, or, you know, more and more coming out experiences that were positive, that I, you know, just kind of stopped, you know, having that that holding back, you know, out of concern of what someone might say or do.
Yeah, that definitely makes sense. And I've had really good moments. And so to reference about part of why I wanted to do this. And I know I sent the emails anonymously, and obviously I'm still using the pseudonym for a few reasons, but part of why I wanted to do this is because it's been moderately important to me of like getting someone out there, and like unfortunately sometimes that someone has to be you if there's not.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I've met a lot of guys who are like surprised that they might be into a trans person, because they're like, oh, like, well, you're just a fat hairy bear, like that's that's what I like, and being surprised that they would be attracted to someone like that. So I think that like representation is important and stuff like that. But then relating that back to like flirting with people at runs, before Tumblr died, I had a more risque Tumblr, but you know, I was still relatively anonymous on it. And I like at this run that I was at, there was someone who I, you know, won't name, but somebody that like I had had, you know, a huge crush on, and was like a very, very popular bear online. And like, you know, I was there with my boyfriend and they knew that, and they were like, oh, you should go talk to him. I was like, no, he's too popular. I'm not going to do that. And then like later at the run, like him coming up to me and talking to me, and I was like shocked, and it was really like, I was floored. And then later he sent me a Facebook friend request, and he was like, hey, I didn't mention it at the run because I was kind of worried it wasn't you, but I know I follow this porn Tumblr. And I was like, what? Like my celebrity crush follows mine?
My celebrity crush is celebrity crushing on me?
Yeah, and I was like, I was like totally shocked, which also was like a really nice revelation, because he came up and talked to me, which was like, felt like I was like floored by. And then but I still had that voice in the back of my head of like, ah, but what if he's a dick about the whole trans thing? So then later, like finding out like, oh no, he's definitely not.
Yeah.
Was quite interesting.
Well, that's good to know that you were pleasantly surprised by the outcome, you know, and I think that's one of the things that comes with that caution in our lives. You don't know how the other individual is going to react. I think about a gentleman that I had met years ago at an event, and we flirted, you know, through the app and this and that. And so we decide to spend some time together, and then he opens up to me about some things about him physically, and I could see in his eyes, like there was this kind of fear, like, you know, about what this moment, you know, would be or whatever. And I, you know, made a conscious effort to not react in ways, you know, to make it uncomfortable, you know, and talk to him. And I thanked him for being, you know, open and honest about it. And we actually kind of side railed for a little while and had a conversation. And I asked about, you know, because this is how my mind is. I'm like, you know, have you had bad reactions and other things? And he said, yeah. And, you know, I appreciated and found like that experience all the more memorable and like enjoyable, mm-hmm. because of the fact that we stopped and had this conversation, as opposed to, you know, making presumptions and or like, I guess my making it awkward by how I would, you know, react to it, you know, negatively, I guess is really what it was about.
Yeah. Well, and I don't know, it's also been interesting because sometimes people's reactions will change when they're like confronted with a trans person. So an example being like, I was at a run like last year, and there's a guy that was very much interested in me, and I did end up hooking up with him. But like when we went back to his room, he was like, I just need to make sure that, like, and you know, he wasn't like being like shady or on the DL or anything. He's like, I just need to make sure that my husband isn't there, because he wasn't like into you being a trans person. And I'm like, oh, that, you know, that's fine. And then like later this year, they were visiting Denver, and I don't think that that his husband had like connected me with being the trans person that he hooked up with, because I thought it was so weird that he said his husband like wasn't interested. I was like, well, your husband has made eyes at me at the pool like a bunch of times. But whatever. And then, like, when they were, you know, in town, like, they were like, hey, you should come out and get dinner with us and, you know, maybe fool around. And let me tell you, his husband was a lot more interested. Because I think his husband had kind of just, like, heard, like, oh, I'm bringing a trans man back to the room, and was like, I don't want to be a part of that. And then was like, oh, you mean that, like, fat ginger? You want to bring that fat ginger back here?
Wait a minute. You didn't say that part. So you wow. You weren't specific enough.
Wow. So it's been interesting seeing how people's reactions can change. But I'm also, you know, I know some people, when they get into, like, hookup space, like, they don't want to have, like, normal conversation during, which for me it varies depending on, like how vanilla to kink the hookup is being, because, like, on the more kink side, I prefer to stay in, like, a certain headspace. But if we're having, like, a more vanilla time, I'm more okay with, like, interruptions and conversation. So we, like, when this couple was visiting, like, I like, it was very interesting because, you know, I went off with his husband for a moment, and, like, he clearly wanted to have, like, you know, not only hook up, but also have, like, a fun conversation, because he was bringing up the fact that, like, he's on, like, he has low testosterone, so he also has to do, like, testosterone injections, and he wanted somebody to bemoan with about how much he hates the needles.
Okay.
Good
to
know. So.
Great way to identify.
So, like, in the middle of making out, he just started talking about that. I was like, yeah, this is fine. Like,
yeah. So we've got a couple of questions from the chat.
Yeah.
Hold on. I'm trying to get back to this.
I got it right here. Owen first asks, how do you go about having a conversation without coming off as rude or offensive? I had asked some things of someone that I was interested in, and without meaning to, I had offended them.
So I think that depends on, like, what you're asking in particular. But I think, like, an easy rule of thumb, and this, you know, might sound silly, but, like, if you're and I'm mostly looking at this from a trans perspective, but if you're, like, interested in someone and, like, don't want to come off as offensive, because some people will have different gauges of what that means, is, like, the first question would be, like, hey, are there any off-limits topics? Like, are there things you don't want me to ask you about? Mm-hmm. And just, like, you know, so you know, okay, that's not a conversation for right now. And then, like, if you're in, like, a flirting perspective, this is something I said in one of my emails to you guys, is, like, you know, just, like, ask them what they want their genitals to be called. Like, that don't make any assumptions on, like, certain people like this and certain people like that. Because I know for me personally, I hate when anybody says anything, like, feminine about my parts. It, like, is an instant turn off, and I'm like, I don't want to be having sex anymore. Like, And, you know, that's not just true about trans people. Like, I was talking about this with my boyfriend before coming on, and, like, that's also true for, like, cis guys, because I know some, like, various tops and bottoms, like, love saying things like boy pussy, and I know various tops and bottoms that are like, nope, that's gross, and you just ruined the mood.
yeah, it happens. Speaking of assumptions, Philip asks, when people find out you're trans, do they automatically assume you're a bottom and don't even bother to ask?
A lot of them do, although I will say I don't, like, come out to people very often face-to-face. You know, most of the time it's, like, on my growler where my stats are listed. So it says that I'm mostly a bottom, so...
Yeah.
So... Yeah. I don't know if I'm reasonably the person to ask about this, because somebody who comes out in different ways might be able to tell people's assumptions more often, because most of the time when I'm flirting with people, they already know, because it says it.
They hopefully
they
know.
Did the research.
I hate it. Which, you know, when you're, like, a cis guy, it's frustrating when people don't read your profile. When somebody doesn't read my profile and just messages me based off my picture, I'm like, hon, you need to stop.
Honey, let me stop you right there. You need to do a quick look. Yeah. And then get back to me. Like read the profile.
Yeah.
And quick scan.
And yeah.
Sometimes you can find the keywords.
Yes. And I'm like, you don't even have to read the profile, just read the stats. Like it's in my stats.
It's part of your profile, so that's part of the schemin. Maybe you didn't get to the text where you go through the whole discussion stuff, but if it's in the stats.
Right.
I have it everywhere. Like it's in the name and my stats and file. Like I'm like, I want you to know.
You are not paying attention.
Like, I'm being very clear about this.
Yeah.
Well, and sometimes people only see what they want to see, you know, in an individual. This is not necessarily like the same thing, but I think of it like, you know, how there have been times I've seen a man and I, you know, like what I see physically, I have this imagination about who they are and their personality and all this kind of stuff. And I think I've discussed it on the podcast before. And then you might have a chance to interact with them and you're kind of like, whoa, okay. Yeah. Like I was hoping for like this ridiculous fantasy of like uber masculine with a basso profundo kind of, you know, deep voice and yada yada. And you are like the lightest lip wristed kind of fairy I've ever met. And that just, you know, kind of dispels the fantasy in the moment. And I think that that's possible for all of us. You know, in meeting other individuals, you kind of have an idea about who they are, and that's not necessarily the case with them, you know, and that's, I think that's more of just a human experience, you know, and that kind of stuff. I was just talking with a friend of mine about, this is kind of a side tangent, but related. We were discussing about how I think his name's John Benjamin, the voice actor who does Archer on the Archer animated series and also does Bob on Bob's Burgers, to see him, like, he does not necessarily look like maybe what you think of that individual. Just like I know in my generation growing up listening to Casey Kasem. Like if you saw a picture of who Casey Kasem was, you were kind of like, what? Like that? I think that's one of those things that happens with people is that they have a presumption, you know, about an individual, whether it be their personality or something else. And then they kind of like, oh, that's not really what I thought. you know, it's, are they paying attention to that kind of stuff?
Yeah.
So TB, I was kind of curious because you've talked about going to like bear events and being in gay male spaces. Have you found like the bear community in general being, you know, open, or has it been, you know, not open, challenging, you know, or is it more like circumstance, like each moment or each experience?
So my experience in general is that it's like usually been pretty open. And honestly, the thing that I have a little bit of a, this might sound silly, but have a harder time with, than being trans there is that I don't drink. So when I go to a lot of gay spaces that are like heavily drinking oriented, I'm like, oh, I feel sort of out of place here.
Because you don't want to join us on Friday.
No, I'm sorry. Your birthday will have to be, you know. Fun.
I mean, to be fair, we do accept designated drivers, which basically Damon is nowadays because we know that he's fucking wasted.
I got fucking wasted, and I'm never gonna have that happen again.
But that doesn't mean that you can't drink. Not to side-rail our conversation with TB, but the truth is, you could drink responsibly. Like, you could have a little bit, you know.
I might, okay?
You don't have to confuse the rules and do practically 1 ounce shots every single minute, because it is no wonder that you practically just was poured onto the floor.
I mean, I got this shot glass, which has a line at 1 ounce. A very clear line. Anywho. So better now. Any case, tangent. Sorry.
You're welcome, TB, to join us, even if you, you know, just want to sit and watch the hilarity of that as it happens. But yeah.
But yeah, like being accepted in gay bear spaces, like it's been, you know, it's usually pretty good. Like, I've had a lot of really good experiences, but then, like, there's the occasional, like, bad one that sticks out of, like, I was at a, like, a bear house party that was happening while I was in college, and, like, there was a couple that I had hooked up with that knew I was trans, and that was it. Like, everyone else didn't, and, like, partway through the party, the host got really drunk and said, like, oh, wouldn't it be funny to Google pictures of vaginas and then make fun of them? And I was like, hey, I need to not be at this house anymore.
Oh my God. Like,
and like the couple that I knew and had hooked up with previously had left like 15 minutes before that. So I couldn't even be like, yeah, you know, hey, you two, why don't I go hang out with you and feel like comfortable in like sort of a safe space here. And you know, like they, like this house was this house that had like this massive, like 70-inch TV. I've never seen a TV this big. And they were like, let's Google vaginas and make fun of them. And I was like, this is such a weird thing to be happening. And like,
first of all,
and like, awkward. Like the host was super into being like, oh, gross. Like every time, as well as like quite a few of the people there. And I was like, why? Like, A, I am uncomfortable on a personal level, but B, why is this fun? Like, why are you enjoying
this? Why is this a thing? Like, why?
Well, I mean, I think that just goes to show, like, quite the level of disrespect, you know, like not understanding and being okay. But I find that, personally, I get challenged often in life when I talk to individuals, and they seem to be so, like, opinionated, like they have to have an opinion about something, you know, that they have to be for it or they have to be against it. And I struggle because I'm like, why can't it just be?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, you know, for me personally, it depends on like the context of the thing. But like, you know, using this as an example, like even if I wasn't trans and was like a cis guy, it felt weird because I'm just like, why do vaginas like have to be gross? Like, even if you don't want to interact with one, it's not like gross that they exist. Like,
I mean, most of the time you kind of came out of one.
Well, I think that people, I think it's just fear. Like, I think it's ignorance and fear about the unknown. They haven't been with one, don't understand it. They have huge preconceived notions about it. And so they just, you know, they make fun of it. I mean, that's really what it comes down to, I think.
Yeah. I mean, I don't. So when I'm like friends with someone on Facebook or like follow them on Twitter or like previously Tumblr or whatever, I don't have like a ton of like hard and fast rules about like, oh, this is a moment when I'm like unfollowing you or unfriending you. But basically it's like, you know, if they post something like super racist or sexist or transphobic, and then like my other one is basically like there is a variation on a joke that, you know, I'm sure we could go find 20 really easily, but it'll be like a picture of like the Predator's face and it'd be like a vagina to a gay man. I'm like, yep, you're gone. Like, like this is, yeah. This is the post that makes me peace out.
Yeah. This shows you how far that some of us go, because several years ago, that's exactly how I would have thought of it. But now occasionally when I'm getting ready for bed and I pull up my iPad, one of the things I search for is FTM trans.
Yeah, well,
so I'm like, my opinion, my view on life is just changed immensely just because I finally took the time to go explore and find something new, and now it's not as scary to me. I would probably be nervous the first time,
yeah,
because it's a first time thing, but
right,
totally. So I'm going to pause for a moment to like, I had a link that I specifically found earlier to send to one of your guys' various chats, just for anyone that like hadn't experience any like trans bear porn. There's a guy that's on Twitter that's pretty good, but you know, so I will send that over to the Telegram, just give me a second. But I mainly wanted to post it just because like I think he's pretty hot. He's a trans guy who hasn't had surgery, and just like, you know, don't click the link if you don't want to, but it, you know, it's just something that like I think that, like, porn-wise, he's pretty decent, but also just, like, even if you aren't into it, it might be, like, more educational to be like, oh, like, this is what this looks like for a trans person.
Getting more exposure.
Which
I feel like that's how I've, like, grown, because we mentioned how for a lot of people, some of this is more of fear of the unknown. And things you're initially not interested in, but then when you go and actually take the time to go and explore it, while there may be an initial shock, I don't know if that's the right word, if you actually try to take the time to actually learn and try to really kind of process those feelings by actually seeing or experiencing, your perspective would change. We're human beings that are ever growing, so
yeah.
And bear with me while I friend somebody up on my porn Tumblr, Twitter, not Tumblr.
I because, you know, if, and like a big part of it is just like something that I've experienced so many times in the bear community is like, oh, I didn't know I could be into this because there isn't that much trans media coverage to begin with. Mm-hmm. And like the mm-hmm. coverage that there is usually for trans women. And then the occasional one that is for trans men is usually for, like, you know, young, slim, hairless trans guys. And like basically the only one that I can think of that's like even moderately famous is Chaz Bono. Which, mm-hmm. If any of you watched the documentary about, like, his starting to transition, he's much hotter now because he has a very big beard now.
Well, and I think one of the things that people get confused about, like, in terms of, like, when they talk about trans identity, is I think that they also want to tag along sexuality to it. So yeah. they make huge presumptions about, because someone comes out as trans, that automatically they're going to probably be heterosexual as a trans individual. So, you know, and it sounds like that might have been a little bit of the case for you, TB. Like, in some cases, people presume that, you know.
Well, yeah, so I mentioned, like, that dinner that my parents threw for, like, the people of their congregation where they could answer questions. And, like, I didn't get, like, an exact play-by-play of everything that happened, but I do know, like, one of the things that they told me that happened was, like, one of the people at the congregation being like, why doesn't she just come out as a lesbian? And, like, my mom having to be like, well, actually, you know, like, he's not attracted to women, so.
Right, and
he likes men.
Yeah, and even then, I think, like, something I've been learning more about that I think in a future show, if we could have someone come on and be a guest, would be good, is to talk about, like, being ace, like, being a person who's not really sexual. Like, I think that is also, like, another arena as a part of our community that can be really challenging, because I think there's a, especially for gay men, I think there's a huge presumption that because we're gay men, whether we be cis or trans, that, you know, we're focusing on the sex. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that may be true in some aspects, but, you know, there's a person I'm following on Twitter who I'm really enjoying, like, seeing them talk about and challenge that concept, that norm, quote unquote, that just because you're a person doesn't mean that you're always sexual.
Yeah.
You know, that you could be a person who doesn't necessarily, it's not that you're anti-sex, but that you're just not a person who's really, you know, into that. You might be more into just cuddling or hanging out, you know, or something of that sort.
Yeah.
And I think that can also be challenging for individuals, but I would hope that I just, in general, for me, I guess, because I've been more open, and especially through the podcast over the years, we've tried to help more people understand different things, including having you being on today, TB, you know, that people kind of expand their look of the world and be like, mm-hmm. you know, everybody has different stories about them. And, you know, it's not always everything that you presume or are told or sold or whatever you want to say, you know, in that case, when it comes up.
Yeah.
before we get to wrapping up here, TB, was there anything else that you wanted to cover or talk about? And not that you had to have an agenda today necessarily, but
I did write myself an email of like things that I wanted to talk about. So let me go reread what I wrote myself to make sure I didn't skip anything.
Arrow said in the chat, sex is cool, but have you ever just sat and watched Netflix with someone you love?
Basically, actually Netflixed and chilled, not quote unquote Netflix and chill.
Netflix and chill.
So I only had really one other thing that this isn't as super important as most of the other things that we talked about, but is certainly interesting. So Caitlyn Jenner came out as trans like previously. And I think it's, there was an episode, like, she had the, like, her show, which was sort of infuriating because of how conservative she still is, at least infuriating for me. But, like, my family made a point to watch one of the episodes of it because she and my dad went to the same college, and I had actually previously given a speech there about, like, LGBT stuff, which I thought was... like, you know, it's just shows you some of the ridiculousness of like television because my dad went to college there, and I actually had a friend that was going to college there and knew some of the staff. She was talking about like being nervous about going to this college to do this thing, and like how her dead name was still on the gym because the gym was named after her when she was, you know, the Olympic star and stuff. And like, it's just a little ridiculous to think about like how overproduced television is, because the moment that she announced she had a new name, the president of the college, who I don't know, but I am very good friends with like one of their coworkers, emailed and said, "Hey, would you like us to rename the gym from the Bruce Jenner gym?"
Okay.
And like on the show, they're like, "This gym still has my old name, and it's like this Christian college." And I'm like, "Bull fucking shit. I gave a speech at this college about LGBT stuff, and they messaged you the day that you picked your new name asking if you wanted the gym renamed." And it was just like, you could tell that this, like, that, like, she'd waited to give an answer for the TV show.
And I think that, you know, you bring up a good point, because we talked pre-show before we were even on air about, you know, a little bit about Drag Race. And, you know, that's something that Damon and I have talked about, you know, that reality television, quote unquote, is not always 100% authentic, you know, real. Some of us are still, you know, coming from this mindset, you know, when the real world was one of the first things that, you know, came about, we presumed that everything we were being shown is true.
Yeah.
Where that's not always necessarily the case. And, you know, and that's unfortunate, you know, that the way things happen and timing and that, you know, and like you said, you know, in terms of like for television, that they, that's what the circumstance was. One of the things, I guess I will say this, is when Caitlyn Jenner, you know, came out, I think a lot of people were like, not taken aback, but like everyone had to like reset themselves.
Yeah.
Because Caitlyn's been the most high profile individual potentially, you know, in our modern era, of someone who was known previously in one circumstance and now has made, you know, a tremendous change in their lives. And everyone had to kind of like, oh, okay, now we're all going to have conversations. Now we're all going to try to, you know, adjust to what the current circumstance is. I think for our community, for the LGBTQ community, we had quite a difficulty with that. Once we found out, with transitioning, you still stayed the same person. And by that, I mean in terms of politics and, you know, your personality in some ways. And I think everybody was like, okay, like, we're not sure how we feel about that.
Yeah, well, yeah, because that worked that direction for Caitlyn Jenner coming out, but, you know, hopefully usually works the opposite direction, like, when you come out to your family of, like, oh, I guess you're still the same person I knew before, just a slightly different, you know, wrapper.
Right. And I think that also can, you know, be confusing for individuals, because everyone makes their own choice in how much they want to change their identity, I guess. And it, like, you know, anybody who comes out for any reason, you know, if you decide that you're no longer, you know, going to, you know, be a carnivore and you're going to be a vegan, like, how do you ascribe that to yourself? Do you make it, you know, kind of the core of your identity of who you are or not? I mean, I feel that way. You know, I was talking about it recently when I came out in college. I was probably one of the biggest flaming homosexuals that existed, but I didn't call myself a homosexual. I called myself gay, because gay was acceptable and gay wasn't focusing on me sucking dick. You know, it was just, you know, about more about my personality and how, you know,
you were happy.
I was very queenie. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. So, you know, but over the years, that's really kind of, I don't want to say gone to the wayside, but, you know, you mature and, you know, you have life experiences. So, you know, you find different ways to handle stuff and how that comes about. And I think that people, I think they prefer, I think the human mind works really well when we can label things and make it clear. And it's the in-between that really messes people up, because they're like, like, I don't know what to do with this thing. And, you know, so then they get all awkward and do stupid shit. So, and I think we're all guilty of that. I know I have been in the past, you know, and I'm still kind of feeling that way when it comes to that stuff now. So, it was really good having you come on today. I really would like to offer up, if you want to come on again and, you know, have other conversations about things. It doesn't necessarily have to be about being a trans individual. You know, I don't want you to feel shoehorned and, you know, be like, although I think we kind of do this. I'm just saying this more to Damon and Jeff. Like, we kind of put people in certain areas, like Hadrian's become our, like, porn expert.
Wait a minute. Aren't we doing, like, a third rendition of the what porn has taught us?
Well, I was thinking more about, like, how we always go to Hadrian for porn. We go to Dr. Sisko for things regarding to, like, science and studies. So,
look, we have our in-house experts.
That's true. But I don't want to necessarily make TP feel that that would always be the case when it comes to this.
Oh, yeah. That also reminds me of something. But we'll talk for later. Anyways.
Okay. Yeah, I could certainly be on again. That would be a lot of fun.
Yay. We would love to have
you. I do hope this was educational.
Very much so. I'm so happy to have you on. Like, you don't believe it.
Very much so.
Okay, maybe it's just because I have this absolutely adorable person on our show. But maybe that's just me. Anyways. Hey, guess what, folks? That's the end. Oh. Plenty of ways to contact us and tell us your thoughts about anything, about what we've talked to you today or any for any show. You can pop over to our website, comesoutloud.com. Shoot us an email at comesoutloud@gmail.com. Leave us a voicemail, sexy or otherwise, at 361-COL-TALK. That's 361-265-8255. There are plenty of places to find us in the social media verse at Comes Out Loud in the appropriate place of the URL. That's Instagram, Facebook, Tumblr, Twitter, and of course on YouTube. You can join our entourage chat, which TB has joined us for, and you can get that super secret link he shared with us at tinyurl.com/telegram-col. You can find out when we're recording these shows at tinyurl.com/calendar-col. You have to do that in a desktop. It doesn't work on mobile, unfortunately. You can get merchandise, such as an apron of our various logos, as well as the Sloppy Button 23 apron, which you could just wear the apron, and that's it. I mean, it's the best way to cook naked. Anyways, you can also get things such as the Comes Out Loud shirt that Gary is wearing, which is a version of our V3 logos.
To be fair, I want to make clarification. If you're seeing the video of this, this is actually not accurate. It was an oops on their part. The color is not correct, but yeah, same concept.
Same style, but
yeah,
better colors. I'm wearing a Bear Consent Is Your Foreplay tank top because all of our shirts have multiple different styles you can get of the shirt. And there should be something that I need to remember to ask about after we get off in regards to Consent Is Your Foreplay. which is very appropriate.
later.
That's all at Zazzle.com/comesoutloud. Keep in mind here, it's not just Zazzle.com/comesoutloud. It is also places like Zazzle.co.uk/comesoutloud, Zazzle.com.au/comesoutloud, and I think it's Zazzle.de. I don't know. If you go to Zazzle.com, if you scroll down to the bottom, you can actually select your localization, select a different country. And it'll tell you the prices and everything. So, but all of them, you can still go to /comesoutloud and get to our store and purchase items from your localization. That way you're not necessarily purchasing directly from the US. It's more appropriate to do it for your own country. Probably cheaper. you can also rate us on iTunes, subscribe to us, Google Play Podcasts, as also Spotify and I believe various other places. I am putting the download links back in the post for those of you who actually just download from the website. That was an oversight of mine. I didn't realize that some people did that. And if that's the way you consume it because of whatever device you use to listen to us, then I will make sure that you have it. Yeah, we got an email from somebody and I'm like, oh, I should have kept those. anyways, you can find me anywhere on the internet. It says box at box puppy box cub box something or other.
Okay, I am TheaterCub79 on most bear related sites like Tumblr. Or you can find me as pup_umbra on Twitter.
If you would like to get in touch with me, you can pretty much find me anywhere online as GareBear73. And to our guest TB, if people want to get in touch with you, is there a way for them to send you like some communication?
Sure. Let me go look up what I have a Twitter that I haven't really used for anything other than liking things right now, and I honestly don't remember what my handle is on it. so give me a second.
That's okay.
You're gonna go there, and it's gonna be blank. But if you want to message me, it would be an easy place to do that thing.
Or a bunch of retweets.
It is at transbuildabear. I can put that in various chats, but no underscores or anything. So
transbuildabear. That's actually kind of.
I couldn't remember if I got the same thing. That's what my Tumblr used to be before.
Hit the retweet button, then you can have something on your feed, even though it's not directly from you. But at least that would be good. With that, I need to click a few things before I say.
Click.
Say good morning, everybody.
Good morning, all.
Have a good one, y'all.
I'd love help what that Gary gave me when I said, say good morning, everybody. I mean, it's morning.
Uh-huh.
Well, I suppose it's afternoon for the two of you.
Also Gary, true, but
over on the East Coast, it's just afternoon.
Yeah.
Literally.
Anyway.
Just afternoon.
Yay. Thank you, TB. This was really awesome.
Yeah, absolutely. I hope that it was interesting and good content.
Oh, without a doubt, for sure. Yes. I definitely think, you know, for your virgin experience with us, that you did very well. So.
Oh, yeah, we popped your podcast cherry.
You did.
We hope you enjoyed it as much as we did.
Yes, it was very nice.
It was so good.
Oh, oh my God.
Jeff.
I mean, he didn't make any sound effects the whole episode, so he has to put them in somewhere.
Oh, called out by the guest.
Nice. I'm not arguing with any of this. Just saying.
Oh, what is that? Oh, that's some... Oh. Shade. It's okay. It's all good.
Okay, I'm going to stop streaming.